Today we're going to talk about visual storytelling. This video is packed with useful tips, so stay until the end. I will do small studies of movie frames as I talk about all the amazing visual storytelling tricks you can learn from cinema, because there's so much to learn. So here we go. On this channel, I present fun and useful things you can do in your sketchbook, and in this video I want to discuss studying movie still frames, because that is a great way you can learn from them. Drawing forces you to look harder. But also, if you are into drawing exercises, please consider subscribing to my newsletter. See the link in the description. YouTube might not show you all my videos, but you are sure to receive each newsletter I send out every Sunday. So subscribe if you don't want to miss them. Doing thumbnail studies of movie stills is a fun thing to do and super easy now that we watch films digitally through Netflix and digital television and such. You can just pause a film and you can really learn a lot from doing so. In this video, I talk about the storytelling tricks you can learn from movie stills as I draw thumbnail studies. If you want to do this drawing exercise yourself, you first have to set up a page with rectangles which you can fill in later. Try to have them roughly the same aspect ratio as film. I used the 16:9 aspect ratio here, which is the standard for digital, and I drew rectangles which were 8 by 4.5 centimeters on two pages of an A4 sized sketchbook. I left some room in between. I added space so that they don't interfere with each other. It can sometimes be confusing when things that happen in different frames somehow visually continue. The aspect ratio might differ from film to film. To be honest, old films were 4:3, whereas modern ones might go up to 21:9, which means they are more than twice as wide as high. For this exercise, though, a roughly flat rectangle that is wider than it is high will be fine. 16:9 will most likely be the aspect ratio you are looking at digitally, so that is a good choice and it is one I used here. You don't necessarily have to do this exercise in a sketchbook. You can do this on anything. I did it in a sketchbook for this video, but a sheet of printer paper is good for this too. For example, you can see me write down the dates first and then I draw a tomato, and each time I finish a drawing for 25 minutes, I add a tick mark next to the tomato to record that I drew for 25 minutes. Writing down the date and filling the sketchbook is part of doing morning pages for artists. Just filling a sketchbook page without thinking. You could do that in front of your computer or television for the exercise I show here. Freeze movie frames and copy them to your sketchbook. In this video, I will show you some of the amazing things you can learn about visual storytelling that way. The 25 minute thing is about Pomodoro, which is Italian for tomato, hence the tomato. I put down a check mark each time I complete one of the 25 minute sessions. It is really satisfying to put down that mark, like it is satisfying to be able to mark something done on your to-do list. After 25 minutes, take a break for a few minutes and then continue drawing. The short break makes sure you can keep going for longer. It is just too easy to get into the flow of things and to run out of steam that way, eventually. I find that if you do Pomodoro, you can keep going for longer, and the breaks allow you to get up and stretch a bit. I am drawing all the frames with a pen here, and I'm doing it in just line. As I studied the still frames I was going to draw, I noticed that the visual storytelling was already conveyed in the line, so I stayed with line. I used these tools for this video, but you might use different tools if you like. You might, for example, try to do it with a pencil and on a sheet of paper. If you do use tones, do try to limit the number of tones you use. Choose the darkest and the lightest tone and one or maybe two tones in between. The reason to stay small is so that you can do them quickly. If you use larger rectangles, it takes more time to fill them. Also, working small prevents you from going into the details too much. Focus on the larger shapes, the larger picture. You will also be less precious with each drawing because it uses up so little paper. You have to make many of them. I am not going to show you the original movie stills for obvious copyright reasons. These little drawings are just studies. I do tend to find that this exercise yields beautiful sketchbook pages, also when you are thumbnailing to think through a new composition for a new piece. A page filled with these sketches looks beautiful, I think, and it is a fun drawing exercise to do. And when you are doing thumbnail designs for your own compositions, you can do that anywhere. You don't need reference for that. Composition design is about being creative about it. But it is important to note that they are just sketches. They don't have to be polished. As you can see in this video, I just did them quickly. I could do around 4 in each Pomodoro, and setting up frames took a Pomodoro. At the end, there were a few easier panels, or maybe I just got restless and started to work faster. These two pages were filled in 5 Pomodoro, or 2.5 hours. I will also be talking about visual storytelling, because that you can learn in spades watching great films. Great films had great cinematographers working on it, directors of photography who knew everything they can do with all the cameras they have available at their disposal, but they also compose the images beautifully and in such a way that the shot choices help support the telling of the story. There is so much that happens in these frames you wouldn't believe. These shots are carefully designed by these directors of photography, as they are called. It is a good idea to look up the best Hollywood cinematographers of all time and to seek out these films and to study them. You can look them up on Google and then go in search of their movies. Some well-known cinematographers are Roger Deakins, Emmanuel Lubezki, Gordon Willis, who did the Godfather trilogies, Jeff Cronenweth, but there are many, many more, of course. One thing that is specific to movies is that because the image is in motion and the viewer can only look at one place, the frames are designed such that you only look at one spot. You cannot have two thing or more things happening at the same time, because the viewer would then not know where to look. This is different for an illustration where, for example, a circular composition is fine. The image stands still, so there is time for the eye to wander around in the composition. This is again different for comics, where the artist wants to lead the eye through the page, from panel to panel. Here are some examples of things the masters of cinematography do so well when it comes to visual storytelling in these movie frames. One thing they can do is enclose a person between two larger shapes to make it look like that person is squeezed in between two things. You can use that as a metaphor for what is actually happening in the movie. Maybe the character is between a rock and a hard place. This trick is mentioned in the book Framed Ink, which is a great, great book about composition for visual storytelling. Here is an example of that, where a boxer seems to be enclosed between two dark curtains, as if he's trapped but fighting against it. The window further gives the feeling of being trapped inside in a metaphorical prison. He is in the center and the composition is almost symmetrical, suggesting stability. In this example from The Godfather, the guy in the middle is a hothead who wants to retaliate against other gangs, but is squeezed between two men who want to calm him down and talk reason to him. Here, with the man locked inside of binoculars, it feels as if that man has been cornered by a stalker. And in this example, again from The Godfather, a guy wants to get acquainted with a girl he wants to marry, and he and the girl walk together. It is in Sicily. Her family follows them to keep an eye on them, and visually they are locked between family left and right, with family members even menacingly carrying weapons, where the guy doesn't. He is surprisingly fragile here, even though he is the son of a mafia boss back home. A similar effect is created when you have a person cornered in one side of the frame with the rest of the world taking center stage. This conveys the feeling that the character is being squeezed into a corner by the world or by life in general. This can be a visual metaphor for what is happening at that moment in the story. In this frame from The Godfather, the consigliere of the mafia goes to a Hollywood producer. In the scene, the consigliere is depicted as being small and insignificant in that larger-than-life environment. He is being pushed into the left side of the frame by all that film equipment on the right. The viewer will not consciously notice these visual metaphors, like you maybe never noticed these yourself. I hadn't. I had to have this pointed out to me, but the audience will feel them. Another great one is to show a person inside, looking outside through a window, with the camera outside. It makes it look as if the character is locked inside somehow, imprisoned somehow. This again can be a visual metaphor for what is actually happening in the movie. Maybe the character is trapped in the situation at that point in the movie. Such a shot conveys that visually. Bonus points if the window has these wooden bars to make it look even more like a prison. If you then have a camera pan out so the window becomes a very small one in a huge wall, it starts to make the character look small in that world and lonely and trapped and insignificant. In a regular illustration, you should always try to make sure an image is balanced, but with film, it is perfectly fine to have frames that are out of balance, because it conveys the idea that the situation is out of balance, and it is just one frame from a movie that unrolls in time. The entire movie is the composition. That one frame is just one frame, So in movies, you can convey the feeling that the situation is out of balance by having the character on one side with nothing on the other side. You see this happen in the first scene of The Social Network, with cinematography done by Jeff Cronenworth, where the guy is sitting with his girlfriend, a balanced situation, as one sits left and the other on the right, and he is rude to his girlfriend and she leaves him. At the end of the scene, he is still sitting there, but she is gone, her side of the table is empty. The frame is out of balance. In this example, a woman is sitting on one side of the frame, maybe a visual metaphor for her personal situation being out of balance. The lines in the background are horizontal and suggest rest and peace. The Social Network is a great, great film to study for cinematography, by the way. In that film, the coloring is brilliant in that the world is depicted with warm colors, and each time you see a screen with Facebook on it, it is shown with cold, white and blue. Those are the Facebook's real colors, but still, it conveys the coldness of online versus the warmth of the real world human connections brilliantly. And also, in that same scene, you can see a hazy background with bubbly lights, suggesting a bubbly party situation again through the abstract shapes. That is another thing. You can use the abstract shapes in the background to convey things. Horizontal lines convey rest, stability. Vertical lines, power and grandness. Diagonal lines convey action, movement. Jagged lines convey turbulent moments, etc. I got this first from the amazing blog Temple of the Seven Golden Camels, which unfortunately isn't updated as much nowadays. I wish the author of that blog wrote a book. But if you can dig into the archives, you will find Composition for Visual Storytelling Gold. I learned so much of what I know about visual storytelling from that blog. The blog's author mentions the book by Andrew Loomis, who has a great book on illustration where he discusses many of the interesting things related to composition and visual storytelling also. Classic visual storytelling trick, and one you will find you can use a lot, is that you can have one person tower over another person to convey that that one person has relative power over that other person. In this frame, you can see that some other mob guy towers over the consigliere of the Godfather at the moment when they think the family is finished. The other mob guy towers over the consigliere, who looks resigned to the fact. In this frame, the megaphone in the foreground clearly visually dominates over the people on the ground who can only stand there and listen to it. In this frame, the guy standing is clearly the dominant figure in the frame, even he is humbly doing something subordinate, like pouring someone a drink. The first scene in the first of the trilogy, The Godfather, with cinematography done by Gordon Willis, does that brilliantly. At the wedding of his daughter, the Godfather receives people who can ask him for a favor, as is custom on such weddings. A man is standing in the room asking for a favor. He is towering over the Godfather and has him cornered. But when the Godfather gets up and circles around the man, and now the Godfather is towering over the other man as he goes into an angry monologue on how insulted he is. The Godfather is also, again, a great, great movie to study for composition designs. The cinematographer for The Godfather clearly studied the past masters. You can see that he lets lines continue from one thing to the other. An edge of a hat may continue into a shoulder, that sort of thing. This doesn't happen by accident. You have to actively design these into your composition, otherwise they won't happen. It's a great way to organize an image, one that is used too little nowadays. These invisible lines help guide the eye through the image and can help create the feeling that the frame tries to convey. As a side note, this is how you can get these lines into your own compositions. Make quick thumbnails designs first, then discover these lines in them, and then create new revised designs where you start with laying down these lines first, before putting things against them. The cinematographer also cleverly grouped people together visually so that the frames read more easily, as you can see here in the following examples. Real life is much more messy. One other thing you can do as a visual storyteller is to use the fact that we read images from left to right, like we read text from left to right. Our eyes are trained to read something in front of us in that direction. So if something moves from left to right or is looking toward the right, it feels like the person is getting a helpful push as it moves in the direction our eyes move into. You can see a man looking to the right here, to a wide open ocean with birds flying freely, This depicts the freedom ahead of him. His facial expression shows that he isn't too happy about it. In this image, a guy is looking to the left, to some wasteland, and we feel his struggle as we read against the direction of his gaze. In both, the cinematographer was careful to put the horizon at around the neck or chest, so the person sticks out over the horizon, to make sure it doesn't feel like they are being cornered by the scene. They are towering over it and looking over it. Sometimes, cinematographers will let a small car or a boat go from the left to the right in the frame, or the other way around. An efficient way to depict a long journey, and the direction tells us whether it is a struggle or not. Here, a car seems to have been blocked from going further by a force of nature, figuratively speaking. The car could very well drive through that hay, of course. The Statue of Liberty in the background is probably also significant, but I'm not sure. I haven't seen the film, to be very honest. Sometimes, especially at the end of a movie, we see a car on the road, and the type of road metaphorically depicts the road in life, so to speak, that the character has ahead of him. It can be a straight road, like shown here, or a curved and winding road depicts the life filled with turmoil ahead. Another thing you can do at the end of the movie, but in combination with the beginning of the movie, is that they can make the first shot and the last shot show the transformation of the entire movie. I won't show examples here, but you can see the first and last shot and know the story, because these two images depict the transition. Framing is just one part of what movie makers do to help convey the story visually. You also have staging, where you decide where all the actors stand and where all the props are, and lighting, so you control the abstract shapes you see, and the color to convey the right feeling, and the music to tell the audience how they're supposed to feel at each moment. During editing, the filmmakers determine how long each shot will be, and that determines how the audience will experience time. Shots that take a lot of time seem to slow down time in the film, whereas short shots speed up time, for example, during action scenes. Held hand cameras help convey a feeling of action also, as everything is on the move. These last tricks are not visible in single frames, but they are a part and parcel of what the cinematographers use to help support the telling of the story, along with the great costumes, great dialogue, great acting, etc. When you have a movie where characters are locked inside and sometimes free outside, the film will use very different lighting and colors to tell you how you are supposed to feel about these two situations. Potential love interests, I find, often represent these two worlds also, so that getting together or leaving those love interests becomes a metaphor for going or leaving those worlds. The love interests can be equally pleasant or unpleasant. Rain or water can act as a metaphor for cleansing a situation. Weather can convey mood, thunder, rain, or sun. If a movie is done well, it will take you on an emotional roller coaster from happy to sad to angry and other emotions, and going from fast-paced action to really slow, calm scenes. This helps keep the film interesting to watch for 2 hours. A film that was just action would be exhausting and boring before long. You need moments where the audience can catch their breath. When you are drawing an illustration, by the way, there is something similar you should do. You can have busy, interesting areas full of detail, but you also need areas in the image that are almost empty, so that the eye can go there and get some rest before it dives back into the details again. It is incredibly interesting to see and notice all these things movie makers add to support the telling of a story. There is a lot of money in movies, so they are able to attract the very best artists in the world, and it really pays to study what they do, because you can learn a lot about the craft of visual storytelling. In these frames, the filmmaker also clearly organized the depth to make sure there is a foreground, middle ground, and a background. Some frames only have two depths, but here are some examples where you see front, middle, and back. It is a good idea to organize your illustrations the same way. Artists usually do these studies in tone, but as I said, as I was studying the frames, I learned that the storytelling aspects were already communicated in the line sketches. These are some of the things you can learn while doing these thumbnail studies of movie still frames. There are many more jewels to be discovered, gold to be mined from cinema when it comes to visual storytelling. As you copy these movie still frames into your sketchbook, think of that moment in the story and see if there are ways you notice the cinematographer conveying aspects of the story visually. Do watch the films you intend to study first, so that you can experience them visually. I have to be honest, I didn't watch all the films I did the thumbnails for here, but it is a good thing to do it first, because then you really get to get the story, so that you can then understand why these frames were designed that way. Then watch the movies again, perhaps several times, to pick them apart and to understand how they work. You will miss these things on the first viewing, as you are engrossed in the multimedia experience. As I mentioned before, the purpose of the channel is to collect fun drawing exercises you can learn a lot from, and I think making thumbnail studies of movie still frames fits the bill. I hope you will try to, if you haven't, All you need is a sketchbook and a pen to sit in front of a screen where you can pause films. Drawing these thumbnails is quick and fun and you can learn a lot. We have come to the end of this video. If you found this useful information and if you want to develop a regular drawing habit, please consider subscribing to my newsletter. See the link in the description. Thank you so much for watching and listening.